from larger corporates, you have a lot of talk on power, infrastructure, foreign exchange. You know, there's some big ticket items, so to speak, problems that go to the very core of the Nigerian economy, the FX supply and issues like that. But this particular project came about, like, we're not pitching to solve the problems of multinationals or very big corporate organizations that actually have access to the corridors of power. This presidential council is focused on MSMEs that make up about 80% of Nigerian businesses and are the economic drivers for our economy. Right. So it looks at they're not small issues by any means, but when you talk to small businesses, it costs them disproportionately. You know, economies of scale. A small business trying to incorporate a business, trying to start off, getting your papers, getting registered, getting access to credit, getting NAFDAC registration, trying to get on the procurement or government procurement database. There's some day-to-day challenges, just access to information and transparency, and all the rent-seeking roadblocks. The problems are well known to, I think, every Nigerian and even non-Nigerians that work in this business climate.
So what do you think are the solutions to these challenges?
Is she going to single-handedly solve the problem?
She's going to try.
Like, that's, that's too
her
much.
And her team.
Which is a fight. So the problems are, they are significant.
Exactly.
But they are not insurmountable. But it needs to be systemic. So people, of course, talk about where the shoe is pinching the most individually. But we've looked at it systemically. We prioritized a couple of issues since we came into operation quarter four in October last year.
Yeah.
And this year we've added some more initiatives. So we have not started working on everything, but we've been systematically going through a number of priority areas to address. And then we keep taking the feedback. So we have a whole work plan. We have a 60-day work plan, a very targeted intervention for the next 2 months that the council approved just on Tuesday. And so there's a countdown to that, and I'll tell you a bit more about that later. But it's a whole year. Yesterday we were in Kano, today we were in Lagos engaging with stakeholders. And from quarter three this year, we'll be going to 6 geopolitical zones to engage. And we're actually engaging also with each state around the country by the end of this year, the stakeholder engagements,
Wow. Mm. Okay, so you guys are really channeling in on this.
Very busy.
Yeah, I suppose so. I guess that's one way of putting it. All right, so what are the factors that determine the ease of doing business here in Nigeria?
Well, you know, the ease of doing business, it really, like I said, everybody comes at it from the issue that comes dearest to you, nearest and dearest. You have a lot of talk about power, you have a lot of talk about the infrastructure. It depends on what segment of the economy you work in.
But that will affect you.
Yes, that will affect you. But there's some things like power that cuts across like everybody, infrastructure, road, rail, access to the ports. If you're an exporter or you're an importer, you need your inputs for manufacturing. So there's a whole gambit, and I can scale it up or down, because from the office of the vice president, really he sees to right from the top down to the most micro of issues. But when the secretariat started operations in October, we sat down and we brainstormed on what are three top things, because he gave us the mandate. The council was like, you cannot end 2016 without at least speaking to some of these issues. Like, we want results immediately.
Addressing them, yes.
So we had to do some scoping and thinking, and we thought, what can we have as just clean priorities right now
that would...
So we went to, the first one was entry and exit of goods, which is like trading across borders, the ports. You have, manufacturing really dropped for a number of reasons, 41 items, all sorts of things. So how do you push that? Both the goods coming in that are inputs and the goods going out. So you have the ports processes, the number of forms you fill, the time it takes, the cost, the number of agencies, every roadblock, like every, I don't want to say a checkpoint, but every human interaction is potentially a rent-seeking opportunity.
Yeah.
So how do you limit that? How do you use technology? So that was one bit. And then entry and exit of persons. So you have the airports, we took it as a national embarrassment, that our toilet smell, there's heat, there's this, there's that.
Yes, please call it as it is.
Yes, no,
no, definitely. Let's not mince our words today.
So really. Yes. And just touts and people everywhere, all shades and colors of uniforms and badges. And Nigerians always just come home upset. Like,
why or do I arrive
step?
Upset.
Yes, yes. When I step out of the plane, why am I, you know,
greeted
just
by
heat,
this
heat and smell? And then why do I have like four people asking me this, that, the other? So we've been working on that with Fan. I'm going through just the infrastructure, the customer experience. Okay. You may have heard that His Excellency the Vice President went to the Lagos Airport.
Oh yes, a surprise. Yes,
yes, yes, yes. That's from the briefing that the council has received on the work going on. So there has been some progress. We've been on this since October. But he just felt it wasn't fast enough, and we have this 60-day timeline. So he said, you know, the next time I'm Lagos, I'm going to stop by there. And he said this on Monday night when I had a briefing meeting with him. Yeah. And I just got a text yesterday morning.
Yeah.
Oh, His Excellency is going to Lagos, and
I mean, that's proactive.
Yeah.
He's and that's, I think that's what Nigerians want. Not just transparency, but they actually want you to say, not you, but you and your team, to actually say and do what it is that you say you're going to do.
Definitely.
Yeah, so definitely. Clarity is needed. Anthony, to get you into the conversation, what do you think about Dr. Jumoke's three main focal points to concentrate on?
No, I think those are the key areas. I know she has not mentioned the ease of registering a business.
Because we're going to talk about that.
Yeah. Ease of property registration, ease of construction permits. Those are key areas too. But I the ports situation is key. We just did a story yesterday of customs abandoning the electronic system and going back to manual operating system. The truth is, most of these things she's saying, we've said it several years. Those of us in business reporting, we say we've heard these things over the
time
years.
Time and time again.
Time and time again. There's a movement, then there's suddenly we see a reversal. There's a movement, you see a reversal. So for me, when I hear these things, the first question I want to ask is, how sustainable are these processes being put in place? I know the attitude challenge. In fact, when Nneka says she's going, I said, well, you're going to climb a mountain. I hope you have the strength to climb that mountain. Because I know the human challenge is even more difficult than the process challenge. So how do you make sure that these processes you are putting in place are sustainable? They are not things that 2 years down the line, when you leave,
they're going to break down.
Yeah, or they're going to break down and everything.
So I guess that's my first question. So I didn't actually finish telling you about. So quarter three last year, the third area was government transparency. And that's just putting information into the hands of Nigerians. Like, it's always very difficult finding out what forms to fill, where to go, what regulations. So the MDAs that are particular customer facing to Nigerian businesses were mandated to update their websites, put in the number of forms, the time, the duration, the cost of the activities, all the information that you need for business people to know. And that was last year. That's still ongoing. We're monitoring. It's now monitoring and evaluation, making sure that that's done and sustainably. You don't just update your website once with the information. If anything changes. Yeah. So some agencies have gone to the next level of, yes, the information is there, but we notice your website is not very user-friendly, it's not very attractive. So there's more work, and there are different reform leaders working on that. Now, this year, we went on to tackle 7 reform areas. That's starting a business, getting credit, trading across borders, getting electricity, construction permits, paying taxes, and registering property. Now, there's 2 prongs to the project, and I'll explain how they're related. So you have the things that Nigerian businesses have given us feedback about. Starting a business always comes into it, paying taxes, property registration. Some are federal, some are state. So the way that the Enabling Business Environment Secretariat works, we work with state governments as well. We work with the National Assembly as well. And for sustainability, we work very, very closely with the MDAs. Immigration Service, Customs Service, FAN, they all have dedicated reform champions that work with the Secretariat, collaborate with the Secretariat. They're still in their offices, but they're the point men for their institutions. And they work very closely on achieving targeted reforms, because the council is very big on measuring and achieving. So there's a lot of deadlines, there's a lot of action, and you know down to the level of who is responsible by name, so that there's no slipping through the cracks. You're right, you mentioned about people. It's not easy changing mindsets and making it sustainable, but that is the plan. And even the IBIS project office is incubated within the NIPC, Nigerian Investment Promotion Commission, because at the end of the day, this is investment promotion is so closely linked, and they're going to, in the end, the civil servants of that institution will be doing what once we've set up. Yeah. So, I mean, there's really a lot I could delve into. Which one would you want me to take first? I can tell you what is going on in any of those seven areas. And
let's do paying taxes, because, you know, that's...
Taxes is a big one. The reason why I say that is because here on Talk Business, a lot of people give us a call. One caller in mind comes into question, Comrade, who said that it takes about 17... He has to fill in 17 different forms in order to pay his taxes. And, you know, he's like, this is just an obstacle. I'm trying to do due diligence and be an upstanding Nigerian citizen who owns a business, ready to pay my taxes. But there at the office, they don't help him. And also, 17 forms. Why is it not condensed and a lot simpler?
I think the other issue is, even, and we're going to help you with a story very soon, because we are sending, maybe let me say it on air now, we'll soon send people to FRS offices to go through the process. Because you go to the offices, and I started some investigations recently, and it says, oh, no, don't come early in the morning because they will not be available.
Wow.
And then when you get there, in fact, one time I wanted to talk to one of them on phone, and the guy said, no, why should I talk to you?
Wow.
And I was like, this is the government which needs so much tax revenues, and the guys on the ground actually don't even have an understanding of the need for tax revenues. So I think I know the challenge. I just said I pity you guys, I understand this thing, but we intend to do a life story on this situation, because I think the people down there don't seem to get the importance of
what it is. Okay, well, thank you. That's wonderful feedback for one. So as you know, Dr. Jumoke is definitely about hearing what we have to say, and the presidency is about hearing and action in it. Mm-hmm. I personally work with the FIRS team in my team, so you're speaking to the right person. One of the things I'm actually trying to do as of next week is to almost take FIRS to the taxpayer. So we're going to go to some of the accountants' offices and sit with them to see exactly where the roadblocks are. I know for a fact that FIRS have set up an e-filing and e-payments platform. It's actually meant to streamline the tax paying process. It's meant to make things easier. There are no forms. If you go there, you determine the amount of tax that you did. There is an online platform. It helps you determine the amount of tax you have to pay. And you pay online. You don't have to interact or go into the FIRS office at all. And this platform is live. It has been live since the end of last year, for sure. So that will make it a lot quicker,
a lot less tedious
for the average person.
Taxes.
That's exactly what, you know, when you talk about an enabling business environment, what does it really mean? Mm-hmm. It's a place where it's easier, simpler, less regulation, you save on time and by implication cost, and then less human interaction. Nobody's stressing you out. You can do more from your office. You don't burn petrol, you know, all those additional costs, because that's what makes people want to pay a bribe. If you know that somebody's going to sit on your approval that you need for your business, you're going to try and circumvent as quickly as you can, just so you can get on with your business. So it's just like cutting to the red tape. So it's almost an implied tax on businesses. So what we try to do is to strip all that. So we take each indicator. So there's two parts to the work. We're very concerned about hearing from Nigerians about the testimonials. Like, I'll be interested by the time you finish your tax story if you dig deep enough, you will come back with some positives, because I know the work that has been going on at FIRS. So I'll be interested for that investigative piece of journalism, and then you will share the testimonials with the Nigerian people.
Yes,
so that will be interesting.
And hopefully, Dr. J, he'll give you an opportunity for you to respond to their findings.
Yes, yes.
On his platform, right?
Yeah.
That would be good. But this is what it takes. This is the level of granularity that it takes. When agencies like CAC we've gotten them to work on stabilizing their online platform so that you can register a business name, you can do a search, end-to-end payments, they're interfacing with FIRS so that they can pay stamp duties. These are all steps that have been taken, approved, and are being implemented. Budget for it, everything, like the tasks down. It's not just a matter of following through on implementation, and that's where we come in, making sure that it gets done. And really, by next week, you see the full, we're trying to break down. So the 60-day plan is very, very detailed. We're trying to have
condense it,
so that we can release it and everybody can follow it. And by the way, you can follow us at EBIS Nigeria on Twitter. And a lot of the information will be coming out like that. So when we have things to communicate, that's why we're here. Today we've been engaging with Lagos businesses. Yesterday we were in Kano. We brought a federal team to partner with our state colleagues and to push through, because a lot of people, it was news to them that you can now do this, you can now do that, you can do this on FIRS, you can do this on CAC website. All the websites have been updated. People are still doubtful, cynical, and rightfully so. There's a trust deficit, and we have to earn back the trust of Nigerians. And we can only do this by consistently working to progressively make Nigeria an easier place to do business. So whether it's registration of construction permits, whatever it is, the steps, getting more and more transparent. And then Lagos State were like, annually they're reviewing their processes to make it continually easier, streamlining. That's where we're at.
And just further on the website thing, like even today at the stakeholder forum here in Lagos, you know, some people had made to mention about, you know, the costs for example at customs or whatever, and we could demonstrate right there and then. We went on the website, on the projector, you could see that we had worked with the customs team to update their website to show you exactly what costs are involved, exactly what procedures are the right procedures. So you have all the information that you need. You just have to go online. So most of these websites, most of these agencies, these government agencies, like Dr. J said, we're really working for it to be, for you to have the information that enables you to do business. So you go on there, if there's any confusion, you go on there, you see everything for yourself. So like I said, the FIRS website, this self-assessment, e-filing, e-payments platform, you're able to go there, and the instructions on how to sign up are there. You get your password, you log in, you pay it. It can be done. You don't need 17 forms, like you said before. It can be done a lot less.
A lot of work is going.
This is good, and you know, this is the platform to let people know that it is not as arduous as you said.
As it has been.
As it has been.
Yeah.
You got, so to speak, you guys are moving forward with the times and making things a lot more simpler for us. And I think eventually you will start to reap the rewards of making things a lot.
I'll tell you one way that, you know, we thought to ourselves, there were almost two schools of thought in government this time last year. Some people that oh my goodness, the ease of doing business, the World Bank rankings, we're 169.
Yes.
We're in company of war-torn countries. This is really awful. Mm. And some people are like, is it rankings that we're really on about? It's about Nigerian businesses, the things that. So this project it straddles both.
Okay.
The World Bank ranking indices, it's empirical, it's not a perfect methodology, but it's an objective criteria by which Nigerians would know that it's a scorecard externally. You cannot influence it as a Nigerian government. Mm. And also non-Nigerians, international investors would know they have a benchmark for the same for 190 countries that, look, if you say starting a business, you rank this, it means something and it's bankable.
Exactly.
So we've been, you know, sadly, in 2006, we were actually ranked 94th, which wasn't like great, but
I was going to get into it.
We were 94th, and then we went into a free fall, just And you know what happens with the doing business ranking is that if you stand still, if you do nothing, you fall.
Yes.
Because
yeah.
other countries are working.
Are working, exactly. Yeah. 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 So while we're being stagnant,
yeah.
which is actually one of my questions. I was going to say, what, you know, what are we doing and why are we stagnant?
Yeah, so we were stagnant.
Okay, actually, why were we stagnant?
Yeah, exactly. we were stagnant because, not because, I know that in the previous administrations there was some effort, but if the effort is not coordinated, your effort doesn't translate into, your motion doesn't translate into movement. Mm-hmm. So there were things going on, but they were disjointed. So it couldn't achieve, you know, it wasn't focused to achieve.
So what you're saying now, if correct me if I'm wrong, is that now in this administration, you're all looking and focusing on the right direction?
So
you're all together in unison.
And the way you get that is by having the political will right from the presidency.
To want to change.
Yes, then you have all the ministers working together in one council.
Yeah.
And then all the MDAs reporting, so it's osmosis. Okay. When they know that the president, the Federal Executive Council, the president himself can pick up the phone and call Officer X at Customs. Oh, by the way, this report came and your name was on the sheet.
Yeah.
What's happening? Mm. Even his boss, everybody down the line knows this can happen. Look, the vice president showed up at the airport. Yeah, so it wasn't that he knew all the information.
He didn't send somebody
else.
And he knew all the information that we've been reporting as a secretariat. So he was able to have a very thorough, there was no window dressing, there was no way for that.
Sure.
So back to the rankings. We went into a free fall. So from last year, we actually started from last
January.
You
want to talk about the mandate? Or
yeah, we started working on getting coordinated. So before the council came into being, the Office of the Vice President had been working on this. The Minister of Industry, Trade and Investment had been working on this. A number of people had been working on this. We had engaged with the World Bank. We sent in a country response. They were shocked. The World Bank team are actually very, very excited for Nigeria because they said they had not had this level of detailed engagement. I was in DC in October. We've had telephone conferences defending Nigeria's reforms. What CAC had been able to achieve, different things, what we're sharing with Nigerians. We also shared it and communicated it to, we had a comprehensive country response memorandum signed by the Deputy Chief of Staff on behalf of the presidency, telling them this, that, the other. So last year, we actually stemmed the tide, and now we're switching it. We had actually, less than 1%, but at least a very slight increment. I was waiting on bated breath, like tenterhooks, for October when the ranking results came out. And it's not because the rankings are all that. It's just because it validates the work that people are doing and then the direction you're going in. And then it's a baseline, like you asked about, starting a business or paying taxes. There's some things that other countries, you can now measure, not even going too far. Ghana, Botswana, Rwanda, Kenya. Looking at our ports, looking at, you know, because it's competitiveness, really. If we don't make our ports work effectively,
it doesn't work.
People go next door, they go to Accra, they go to Cotonou.
Money,
Nigerians,
revenue is lost,
and I'm not talking about foreign investors. Nigerians export through Ghana. So, you know, because Nigerians import through Cotonou, it's just their businesses. So it's where it's easy, where it's fast, where it's transparent, where the hassle is less.
Business in Nigeria with our special guest, the Senior Special Assistant to the President on Industry, Trade and Investment, Dr. Jumoke Oduwole. Joining her is Editor at Business Day Nigeria, Anthony Osae Brown, and also joining the two of them is Reform Leader. I've got your title right, is that correct?
Yes.
Yes, Nneka Ekwuozor. Welcome back. Now, I want to go into a couple of the tweets that we've got so far before we engage with the listeners. And then we're also going to talk about our ranking a little bit more and the mandate that was put out there. All right. Victor BPR says, interest rates on loans from banks are horrifying. Lack of power, infrastructure, and telcos are making internet expensive now. He went further on to say, less talk and more actions. The acting president just showed us the way with that visit to the airport. Hashtag no more rhetorics. he goes on to say, Nigeria's internet users dropped by 1.7 million in 3 months, according to the NCC. He says it's just expensive now, given the economic hardship. And finally, he says the CAC says it's aiming to achieve the registration of business in less than 4 hours. Dr. Jumoke, which one of those tweets do you, or yes, where would you like to start?
Thank you very much, Victor. I see you're really engaged, and that is exactly what I want to hear. Okay. I want you to hold CAC to that promise, because they've made it to us, and not just talk. We know the steps that are being taken to achieve that. So when you come down to about 4 hours, that means that basically in less than a day, that means that it's totally online.
Yes.
You can upload the documents, you can pay virtually, you can use electronic signatures, you can have your stamp duties paid electronically. Okay. Mm-hmm. And every one of those things, it's not the immediate goal. The immediate goals for the next 60 days are clear. They need to stabilize their platform for consistency. They're switching their hosting of their servers. Mm-hmm. We're taking some bold steps to make sure that the issues that used to happen, and the government is actually budgeted for,
yeah,
you'll notice that we're putting our money where our mouth is on this project. So it's not just talk.
Yeah, yes. And there was a lady, funny enough, she was a leader of women's group in Kanu, that had mentioned about the work that CAC had done in the last few, was it years or months? Like the last time that she tried to register a company took her 6 months. And she actually gave a testimonial to the fact, and she was very critical of us, by the way. It wasn't like, I'm not even just using, I'm using it as an example because she actually had positive things to say. So she said, like, I think it was this time, maybe last year, she tried to register a company and it actually took her a week. So they have been progressively improving. So like Dr. Jumoke said, please,
whatever
works. Please do hold them accountable to what they say, have promised,
yeah,
because it is going to come to fruition. We can pretty much guarantee that we're working hard.
You seem a bit nervous to guarantee that.
I'm not nervous at all.
Pretty much guarantee, because even 2 weeks ago, the Honourable Minister, their supervising Minister of Industry, Trade and Investment, sent in a directive based on all the scoping that we've done.
Yes.
And really, he did not ask of them anything that is not achievable.
Achievable.
And the timelines he gave. So the 4 hours is not the immediate deadline, but definitely within under a week,
okay,
anywhere across the country, a business should be able to be registered. Eventually, yes, by the time we have the complete solutions, technology solutions, which take quite a bit of planning, cost, and then training of personnel, we will get to that 4 hours, because other places in the world
are doing it.
Yeah,
so
you
why
can
do
register
we
a business from
backwards
anywhere. So there's some things, and then another thing that is a bit tricky that we're working on, some of the legislations need to be changed, and we're working very closely with the National Assembly. You may have noticed that we had an expanded PEBEC meeting, that's the Presidential and Business Environment Council.
Yes.
And the leadership of the National Assembly, both the President and the Speaker, attended.
That's,
and we know about the 11
both
priorities
came.
They came. They know about the 11 priority bills.
Bills, yeah.
You know, the Acting President just signed some bills.
Oh, yes,
law.
He did.
Yes, yes. And
some are being questioned, but yeah.
Yeah, and the ones he questioned, he wrote. He wrote four separate letters explaining
why.
Yes, and they were very appreciative of that. So it's a very good relationship. We're working closely together. They've been working on ease of doing business for over a year as well.
Okay.
I think a lot of things are happening that are different to the past. But again, I think one of the things that this government has a problem with is communication. Back to this CAC thing. We're within walking distance of our office, so we literally have had meetings with them almost on a weekly basis to hold them to account.
Yeah.
And they have to report the progress that they're making and all the rest of it. So it's not a target that doesn't have actual monitoring and evaluation. We're monitoring them at every step, and when they fall behind, they have to answer to it.
Okay, basically. That's fair.
And kind of again on the government accountability side of things, right?
Yes.
So even just a little bit off topic, but this was like the first time the budget was actually open to a public hearing where people could come and, you know, question bits and bobs of the budget back to the government, and they were open to listen. So these are things that are happening, that the change has happened, but I feel like most people are not hearing it for some reason.
I agree with you. I don't think that they're hearing
it's
it,
because,
which is...
It's because, you know, things are tough. It's not like... you know, sometimes if you're in pain, your favorite song will be playing and you don't hear it, because where your mind is right then...
It's not focused on the song.
Yes. So it's going to take putting it on repeat.
Yes.
Yes. So we have to keep the communication. We've taken the point as an administration very strongly since last year. You will hear that the complaints on communication have gone down because we've taken an active...
I also think that it's also a case of trust, that perhaps in the past it has been said, but I feel like what you're... The difference now is that you're going to drive it home and say, no, we're not just saying, we're saying and doing, and we are being open and transparent about what effectively doing.
And we can say it with all confidence, because this is the work, you know, the vice president released me. A lot of my duties from the office of the vice president have been put on, you know, they've been delegated, released me to focus on this.
This is amazing.
Yeah. So okay, I can say categorically that, and in there I poached.
Yes, we did.
She's also helping with communication. Yeah, that's another thing she does.
I'm interested in how are you getting the states involved in this? I know in 2014 they did the World Bank did a focused report on the states, and of course we had differing performances with Bauchi emerging as the easiest place to do business.
Well, I'll tell you a bit about the
So I'm wondering, how are you getting the states involved, because the states will play a critical role?
The rankings are a year ahead, so we're currently in the 2017 rankings.
Yes,
so for the 2018 rankings, which will be released in October, we will move at least 20 places.
Okay. So we'd like a progress report here on Talk Business.
Oh, definitely.
Yeah.
Definitely.
We'll congratulate you. I'm putting faith in all that you're saying. So by September, October, maybe.
We'll break the bottle.
Yes, we can congratulate you.
And the 20 places is not random.
Yeah.
So the sub-Saharan Africa average is about 140-something.
Okay.
And really... Nigeria is the largest economy.
I mean,
we are West Africa, forgive my other friends. But you know, really, we're not by any measure where we should be. So the least we could do is be at the sub-Saharan African average. We actually internally have a much more aggressive target.
But you don't want to share this. Then over. I totally agree with you.
Even if it seems like we're talking about the rankings a lot, you have to understand, everybody quotes these rankings around the world, right?
Yeah. No one. It makes the headlines.
It does make the headlines. And it seems, you know, if you're not moving up it, you kind of have to move up it for people to be interested. You know, I've said it in the past on the program, you know, we need foreign direct investment. If someone that has a lot of money to invest looks at the rankings, Nigeria is not the first place they're going to want to put their money in, which is why, especially given the fact that we're in a recession, that's why we're working even harder for us to move up the rankings. It's very pertinent for our economy.
To do this at this difficult time.
And what's important about the ranking is that it picks at 8 indices. And if you look at those 8 indices, Nigeria actually performs very woefully on a lot of those indices. I think on...
paying taxes.
Our best ranking is on...
Access
to credit. But we have...
I'm going to share something with you. I'm going to share something that's going to blow your mind. Let me tell you something about the rankings. What's our population in Nigeria?
170.
Approximately.
180.
How many businesses do you think
182, according to the World Bank.
Yeah. How many businesses do you think are like active, like...
I don't know. I know we have we're supposed to have 400,000 registered.
Let's use
400,000.
Uh-oh.
Getting electricity, our current ranking, you can check this.
Is
181 out of 189, 190 countries. Yeah. Do you know how many people filled a World Bank survey on Nigeria's economy?
Nine.
So things are not very well verified.
Nine.
Trading across borders, our ports. Do you know how many people filled a questionnaire to talk about the Nigerian economy?
And trading across borders,
eight people.
Eight. So we're not actually.
This is not accurate then.
Well, you know
what? Accuracy.
You know, easily. What's their stress level? Yeah.
Okay. It is 51 minutes past the hour of four. I think before we wrap up, it'd be good to get the listeners' participation. All right, so you can join us on the phone lines by giving us a call on any one of our six hotlines. It is 0809 191 3913 or 0809 222 0913. We also have 0809 234 5913. And on the landlines, it is 01 236 7913 or 01 280 2913. And lastly, it is Hello.
You have a full team there.
A very full team here.
Hello. Yes, the good doctor, the Baroness Nneka, and Anthony.
Hello. Hi. Who is this?
DeVoe. Right. DeVoe.
DeVoe, you
all right,
here
DeVoe.
Please join the conversation and keep it short and succinct.
Yes, I wanted please to commend the efforts, but we are concerned about the sustainability, because at the end of the day, it is the same Nigerian people who form the civil service that will sustain this. And it almost sounds as if you're now the one governing, if the doctor understands what I'm trying to say. Because what you're doing is what basically ideally should have been done, but we haven't done it for all the various reasons. Now, there are three areas I just wanted to point out. I don't know whether they form part of your priority locations. One, SEME border. SEME represents the biggest trade outlets in West Africa. It's the Nigerian side of the border that's incomplete. There's no border actually. They're just fences and about 10 different roads, which you have already said are rent-seeking opportunities. Mm-hmm. Is that going to be addressed? Because it's road does not mean it deserves less attention than an airport. You need to go there. First of all, it takes 3 hours from Festac to Sema border because of all the potholes on the road. And once you cross into Cotonou, it's smooth. But there's no border. They left what they were intending to build as a border. They left it over like 20 years now, and then they create some rickety corridors that all the NDLA customs, immigration, NAFTA can cooperate. That's one. Mm-hmm. Secondly, visa on arrival. You mentioned it, but I don't know what has been done about that. In as much as we travel to other countries, there are millions of people that want to come to Nigeria, especially mm-hmm. for business, besides travel, hospitality, and co. Mm. This never happens. I'm told by every one of my friends, especially even those that are frustrated by business, that they have to more or less bribe Nigerian embassy officials just to get a booking before they even get another stamp on their visas. Then lastly, is there a platform for feedback like customer service? Because at the end of the day, even if maybe a few people know Nneka, a few people know you, maybe now you're not going to be on air every week. So how do we as Nigerians, 190 million of us around the world, how do we call in? Because it's not just Nigerians in Nigeria that are doing business. There are Nigerians outside Nigeria who are doing business in Nigeria. Well, how do we call in, lay our complaints? Because you know, calling the ministry is a dead end. Calling the state government is a dead end. Mm. So let's be real about the situation.
Okay.
Is there something that's going to be transparent, open, so that everybody will see where the issues are coming out from? Almost like the way the telco operators, you know, they attend to us.
Thank you, DeVoe.
Hey.
Dr. Jumoke, we do have another call, but I know you want to address that. Let's just quickly take this
okay
call.
Okay. I think, DeVoe, thank you very much. Those are great comments. I think I'm going to start where you ended, talking about how do you give customer feedback? Do we have a website? Where can you send emails? Where can you call? You know, we're in two minds, and we haven't quite decided. Well, now we've basically decided that we will have our own website coming up very shortly and our own feedback channels directly. Mm-hmm. But I'll start with your first comment about sustainability. We're actually working with the MDAs. This is a project office. If you're used to speaking to us, then how does it become sustainable? How do we get the MDAs into the practice of responding to feedback themselves directly? Mm-hmm. It becomes everything comes to IBIS, goes through PEBEC, and by the way, 2018 July, it's a project. And NIPC should be the custodian of this project, actually.
Okay.
long-term, sustainable. We even work out of their building. We have a floor in their head office because we very much want to work with civil servants to make that change. It's not about, we don't want to change that it's for this administration and we go on everything on rallies. I mean, that would break my heart. Like,
yes.
All the work you pour in. So we very much want to work with MDAs. We've worked on them. I talked about the transparency reform to build their websites. There's Servicom. There's a lot of opportunities for feedback, but it's now the implementation. You talked about people, and that's where it's all linked. But I like the comment, it's great. Seme Boda, how can anybody really talk about ease of doing business,
without
Nigeria, West Africa, even just informal sector alone, and not look at Seme Boda? It's definitely, first of all, on a serious note, we have the Nigeria Single Window Project that has been trying to come live on stream properly for a number of years. But just the political will of bringing all the different actors together. Now under the chairmanship of the His Excellency the Vice President, it's live. So feasibility, all that, business, it's because it's going to be a PPP. All the business plan is ready. It's chaired by, it's co-chaired by Customs and NPA. And then all the other stakeholders are party to the steering committee that is agreeing the implementation, because I talked about the fragmenting and the lack of proper coordination and getting all the stakeholders, letting everybody feel like you're not going to be shut out. And you know everybody wants there to do their job, to have their relevance.
Yeah.
So when you all agree together that, look, you get to do your job, you're quarantined, that doesn't mean you have to be at the port or at the border. If you have access to the single window, it's a technology solution, then you sit in your office and you can see
how
everything down
together
to scanning images of whatever is in a container or what is coming in. So there's already work on that.
How do you contact us? For now, you can tweet at us at our Twitter handle, which is EBES Nigeria, which stands for Enabling Business Environment Secretariat Nigeria. So if there's something that you directly, and people have been directly wanting to raise with us, we read it. Even our communications guy is here with us. He's always on the Twitter handle. So if there's something that you directly want to raise with us, we guarantee you will always give you an answer. It might not be the answer you want, but we'll always
truth.
Get a
yeah.
response.
Where it's work in progress, here it's work in
yes.
progress.
Okay, we'll decentralize it.
Business registration is actually decentralized.
Yeah,
in the
okay.
past, you needed to go to Abuja
to do it.
To do it, but now you can start to finish. They have two offices in Lagos, offices in Kano, around the country.
This is why it's good that you're here, because the likes of Alex don't know this.
Well, maybe it was an old experience,
maybe,
but a lot has happened. Now we take the point on communication. Now we're ready to push out.
And CAC even said that they were planning for 21 more offices at the stakeholder meeting in Kano yesterday around the country. To make it easier. And there's a lot of that process that you can now actually complete online too. So before, you would have to go to from the CAC office, the FIRS office, to get a stamp duty approval, a literal stamp on the form, and then take it back to the CAC office. One of the things that they did in the short term to circumvent that is to have someone from FIRS sit in the CAC office so you don't have to do that. And then, now in addition, they've now trying to launch, in the next couple of weeks, they're going to launch the online platform where you can do e-stamping of stamp duty.
Oh.
So that whole process will be eliminated.
And
so,
there are timelines.
Yeah.
It's not, when you say, sometimes when people say,
we're doing this, we're doing
that.
Yeah,
the go live date is actually meant to be the 28th of February. So,
I really like this. I like all that I'm hearing. It sounds positive to me, anyway.
Not only are you doing it,
but you're saying 60 days, and this is the end day, and this is what you're doing. So it's nice.
Hold us accountable.
This.
We're fine with that.
Yeah, no, I think that it is wonderful. We are hoping we'll be on this side testing the processes seeing that they work and holding them accountable, especially now that I know Nneka is somebody I want to trip down there. So we'll be holding them accountable and seeing that it's done. But I think you didn't answer the question on the states getting involved in these processes.
Thank you very much. I'm glad that you brought that up. Now, I said already that we've been working with Lagos and Kano states.
Okay.
First of all, backing up a bit, last year,
we made presentations to the National Economic Council. That's the Council of Governors, chaired by His Excellency the Vice President. So they all know about this. And you talked about the subnational rankings. Yeah, that's what you're referring to. The last one is done every 3 years. So this year, it's actually being done. There's actually a work plan. Remember when I started talking in the beginning, I said in quarter three, we're going to 6 geopolitical zones, and then after that, every state. Yeah. It's because we're actually coordinating the subnational push for the government as well. Okay. So once we're done with the national ones, like I said, you know, you finish your exam, you submit your paper, and then you now spread it, geopolitical zones. There are already states, Kaduna, Anambra, Ogun. There are already some states that are already working on this, and we've had discussions. But systemically now, we have a work plan for subnational ease of doing business.
Okay, let's go back to the phone line and try to get this call. Okay, we lost that.
What are we doing about security as an ease of doing business question? Now, he's absolutely right.
Mm-hmm.
Because when you come to discussing, there have been some priorities. Okay, let me back up a bit. This administration, some of our key focuses, solid minerals, agribusiness. If I take just those two, and manufacturing. If I take just those two, you have people, if you want to prospect for solid minerals, it's not something you do in the city. You go into the bush, and this kidnapping thing, honestly, even a German professor was kidnapped just a few days ago. Yeah. And the permanent secretary for the Ministry of Solid Minerals actually cornered me on this matter that he had two things. Like, he is trying to attract
people to
business,
come
in, And then when people come, he has to be so worried about getting security for the teams that contact the ministry. And then the second thing he had was, when you bring in prospective equipment, it's supposed to be duty-free because you're still scoping the country.
Okay.
And he was having some challenges with customs. So these are specific problems that government is not unmindful of. Determining, like I said, to be systematic, we're working through stage by stage. Not to say security is not being addressed by the security organs, but as an ease of doing business matter, we are definitely aware that it's a big situation, but it's not something that is on the list
because
actually there's a whole different security strategy on kidnapping alone.
All right, let's go back to the phone lines very quickly. It is like
that's very generic, as you know I hate generic questions.
No worries, I'm industry trade and investment.
Yeah,
I think what Alex is getting at is that, how do you protect domestic manufacturers when you open up your market to a lot of imports? The price of manufacturing in Nigeria is high because of power infrastructure, so you have challenges being as cheap as competitive producers like China, you know, all sorts of places are really competitive price wise because they have economies of scale. Also the type of machines you use, Alex, actually, if we go through, like, before I even get to textiles, because cotton, textile and garments is actually a new policy. I worked on it last year. The Honorable Minister of State Industry, Trade and Investment is championing that because she does a lot of focusing on SMEs, right from our cotton. Because the textile manufacturers, they need inputs, and those inputs are imported.
Mm.
And the garment producers want to import cheaper textiles than buying here.
Sure.
The textile manufacturers want to import cheaper yarn than buying from the cotton farmers. The cotton farmers are either, because they're not patronized enough, they're exporting like low quality cotton, or even if it's high quality cotton, the value chain internally is not looped. So we've been doing a lot of work on looping our internal value chains and our regional value chains before we pay out, because every payment is a job lost in Nigeria. So before we pay out Forex to a job in China, let's see whether we can
hone in here at home.
10 jobs at home. A job in West Africa, something. Let's keep the money within us for a while longer. Then you can export more sophisticated. And he is so dedicated, and they're getting a bumper harvest. That's rice. Rice farmers are smiling to the bank.
Honestly,
ask anybody in rice. There's tomatoes.
Okay.
Tomato farmers, we've been working with them. They come, you know, His Excellency the Vice President is pretty hands-on. I'm not just saying it because he's my boss, but
yeah.
Actually, he takes the time to meet with rice and wheat farmers,
okay,
tomato farmers. As in, they've come, they've been invited to the villa to talk about, how to solve it, and we've mapped out the issues, and it's actually what value Alex chain. was talking about, and making sure that there's a whole thing, there's the 41 items, there's the importation of AAA tomato paste, and how it affects our own domestic farmers. There's a colossal amount of work that has been done. Those are just two examples.
We've talked about lake rice quite a lot on this program. Actually why they were. The Anchors Rose program and lake rice, and the fact that we need to patronize, not just, you know, it's well and good them producing the rice, but we actually need to patronize the local rice.
Let's not just talk the talk. We have to consume what we produce, and we have to produce what we consume. In every aspect.
You're going to have to change the mindset of a lot of Nigerians to do that. And it starts, it's slow, but it starts here. And if you guys keep pressing on, then eventually the message will get home.
There's a point that Anthony talked about Nigeria under-importing. So the big thing about importing and exporting, if you check globally, it's net. The biggest importers are the biggest exporters. The US economy, the Chinese economy. But it is what do you import? Where's your balance of trade?
Yeah.
Do we export the cheapest primary product and import the most expensive?
Those are the things
we have to produce.
Change.
Sophisticated. Quality. We have to add value and then export sophisticated exports, and then we have to just import inputs for our manufacturing
materials.
So it's that restructuring. When we keep actually when. The president, when the vice president, when the ministers keep talking about restructuring our economy, moving it from over dependence on oil, these are the things that they're talking about.
You know, far too many times have I heard our reliance on oil really has to stop, and we have to diversify the economy.
And now you're hearing it.
I believe you now.
I think the issue about diversifying, we are not diversifying the economy per se. We are diversifying the government's revenue base. Because the government depends mostly on oil revenues. So,
because the economy is actually quite
diverse. You need to make the other aspects of the economy support the government.
Business
is important.
Thank you. Let's go to the court. It is Lagos Talks. Valid.
It's an extremely. It's a good question. He's spot on. I like the way he's thinking through his business. I like the way he's managing his expansion. I like the way he understands the implication of taking credit at such high interest rates. Damilare, it's a systemic problem, right from the government, borrowing domestically. We all know the FX challenges. It's outside the scope of the ease of doing business, but it's a white elephant in the room. What I would say is that there are Bank of Industry does give out loans. Of course, there's criteria. And we've challenged them so much last year on single-digit loans. We have to have it. Because businesses like yours are actually almost a case study of the engine of the economy. Businesses that employ less than 10 people. If we can get millions of companies like that, then that's the best. Rather than having one business that employs 500 people and something, FX goes up and they sack 250 people. When you have the smaller companies, it's much more sustainable. So I would urge you, hang in there. It's a painful period for Nigeria. This restructuring of government's actual earning capacity and how we sort of tweak the economy, we actually have to all do it in partnership and move together. There are also some things that we're pushing on the getting credit indicators. There's collateral registry from the CBN, it's live, and there are credit bureaus. These are some things that we're putting in place, legal framework now, to make sure that banks are more comfortable to lend. And we're pushing on banks. The CBN is actually working on it, and the federal government has asked the CBN, please see how these interest rates can come down. The federal government is trying to get out of domestic borrowing. We had the successful Euro bond just a couple of weeks ago. We're trying to get out of domestic borrowing. So we stop crowding out domestic businesses. From the I don't want to go into.
We're gonna get part two on this, aren't we?
Yeah, I don't want to go out of ease of doing business. Yeah. But damn, Larry, just keep working hard.
Yeah.
Keep being reasonably conservative. Maybe this may not be the best time for expanding if you have to take a loan at those high percentages. But definitely, yours are the kind of businesses that we want to see thrive. Thank you for calling.
Thank you. Dr. Jumoke, thank you so much for your advice for, you know, to everyone that has weighed into today's conversation. The time is 20 minutes past the hour of five. Sadly, very, very sadly, we do have to wrap up. Yes, 20 minutes past the hour of five. Time flies when you're talking business. Henry Manuel, I'll just go through some of the tweets. Henry Manuel says, the proof beat of the ease of doing business by Dr. Jumoke and Baroness Nneka. I appreciate your work, but more needs to be done as the foot soldiers that are the first point of contact really do need reorientation and training, perhaps. He says, I will also like a synergy with telcos. We need them to drive this tech. We need them to drive this technologically for us. The plan to scrap apps like WhatsApp and other apps that make MSME businesses easy, as we know power is far from it for now. It's a slow work in progress for power.
Correct.
Yeah, I like that. Nice.
Correct. I mean, there's, everything you said is spot on.
Okay.
And we know these issues and we're working on them.
All right, so let's wrap up with short-term goals. Well, that good-term goals is making us 149 by...
And the long-term goal is actually by 2019 we should be top 100. Let's
top just put it out 100. There. All right. I would love, love, love for you to come back for a progress report here on Talk Business and let us know how you're going. But I think if I've got anything from all of you today is that there is a lot of clarity and accountability moving forward. So I wish you all the best of luck on the ease of doing business and everything else. Seeing as you wear a lot of hats, Dr.
Yes.
Jumoke.
Yeah. Yeah. Thanks for having me.
Thank you so much. And thank you to you, Anthony Osae Brown, as well as you, Nneka Ekwuozor. That is
thanks for
it.
Having me.
All right.